Yeah, so next up is categorical features in univariate. So right now we looked at numeric features, now we are going to look at categorical features, but one at a time, right? Univariate analysis. So for doing that, the most important, most basic thing is you can use count plots, right? So what are count plots? It's basically nothing but for each of the different, so categorical variable, what does the data look like? The data is basically different classes of the category, right? So houses could be colored blue, red, green. So those are different colors, right? And you could have colors in, you could have houses in different colors. So count plot is nothing but basically plotting the number of houses which are colored blue, which are colored green, which are colored red, right? So that's it. So for each of the categorical variable, we can basically plot the different classes and the frequency of the classes, right? That's what we are gonna do. So this is a sale condition. So sale condition comes in what, 3, 4, 5, 6 variables, right? So there's one which is normal, there's abnormal, there's partial, there's adjudicated land, adjacent land, allocated, family. So these are 5, 6 different classes in which the categorical variable comes. And you can see the count of houses which are normal, which have normal sale condition, which have abnormal sale condition, which have partial sale condition, right? So count plots are very simple and easy to understand. Similarly for neighborhood, these are the different neighborhoods in New York, and you can see the houses, number of houses in each of them, right? So that's how you can visualize categorical data in univariate analysis, right? So that's very simple and easy to understand. The next part is multivariate analysis. So what is multivariate analysis? Multivariate analysis, now you're not going to look at one variable at a time, you're going to look at two variables at a time, right? So you're going to look at variable one and how that is kind of varying with respect to another particular variable, right? So in that case, again, there could be three basic types of differences, right? So one is where you plot numeric versus numeric, you basically see how one numeric variable is varying with another numeric. There's another where you plot numeric versus categorical, and then there's categorical versus categorical. Also, another aspect of this variation, instead of looking at, you know, category variable types, we can also look at feature versus feature and target, feature versus target, right? So if you're looking at a supervised machine learning paradigm, right? So if you're looking from a supervised machine learning algorithm, you may also want to plot sales price versus all other features, or features versus each other. So that's one way of looking at it. The other way of looking at it is numeric versus numeric, numeric versus categoric, and categoric versus categoric. So first up is numeric versus numeric. And for this kind of plot, John uses a scatter plot for two variables. Like the most easiest thing that you can do with doing all of this is basically do a scatter plot. Scatter plot is the most easiest and conventional way of plotting any numeric versus numeric data, right? So scatter plot is nothing but every coordinate, every dot or bubble or whatever it is basically represents corresponding house, right? So corresponding house with a sales price and corresponding house with a living area. So any house, it's all those dots in the scatter plot are basically representing individual houses, right? With the scatter plot as the y coordinate. So scatter plot basically represents nothing but all those dots that you see on the scatter plot are representing individual houses, right? With the x coordinate as living area and the y coordinate as the sales price of that house, right? So you are plotting each house as a different dot or bubble on the XY plot, right? So, and the other thing that you need to keep in mind is in case of seaborn, which is an awesome, I have already said, an awesome library. So if you are doing linear regression and what comes very awesomely free with this particular plot, which is called LM plot. LM plot is basically a type of scatter plot in seaborn. It's nothing but it's exactly a seaborn scatter plot. But the good part about this plot, LM plot, is that it gives you a free feature, which is basically fitting a regression line, right? That whole gradient descent thing, that whole finding out the best pair of beta naught, beta one, all of those things, the things that you did using sklearn during dot fit, all of those things you don't need to do anymore. LM plot just directly, if you just ask it to fit a regression line, which is by using this parameter fit reg, it would basically give you a straight line fitted on top of your scatter data, right? So that's exactly the line that you see here passing along, right? So you have got all the data points, as I was saying, all the data points are basically different houses, right? With the y coordinate as sales price and the x coordinate as living area. And once you plot, when you do a fit reg equals to true, it basically fits this nice blue line on top of it, which is basically nothing but the linear regression line, the basic linear regression, right? No advanced linear regression, anything, just a basic linear regression that you're familiar with. So using scatterplot, John can also detect multivariate outliers. Now if you remember, we have talked about outlier detection, and we have talked that, and we talk multivariate outlier in this case, which are two houses which have an area greater above 4500 and they don't follow the trend, are basically the houses which are outliers, right? So removing them would probably give a better fit. So that's the idea of using scatterplot. John also could use a joint plot, which gives a plethora of information in a single plot, right? So apart from scatterplot, this scatterplot was the basic thing that you use in matplotlib. Lmplot was something on top of scatterplot, which basically fitted a line. Now there's something called John plot, which basically is something on top of lmplot, which gives you certainly a bit more of information, right? So apart from fitting the straight line, what it also does is it does some statistical test to basically figure out the goodness of fit test. So it says a p-value of 9 × 10⁻⁵, which basically means that the line can be kind of trusted fairly well, right? So we have fit a robust line. That's what it says. And then you have also see the distributions of both the x as well as the y variable on both sides of the axis, which is fantastic, right? Now this is a very nice way of summarizing information, right? So you have got your box plots. You have got your scatter plot, that is the most basic thing, and then you fit a regression line of top. You have got a statistical inference test done on with that, and now you also have the histogram variation of both the variables x and y independently on different axes, right? So on top you have basically the distribution of x, and on right you have the distribution of y, right? And that's fantastic, and along with the kernel density estimation done on top of each of them. Wow. That is a lot of information, right? Apart from that, also you can use something called a hex plot. Hex plot is something very similar. It does a histogram again without the kernel density estimation though. What it does is it also basically, instead of kind of basically bubbles being representing different houses, it basically now, instead of using a single bubble for each of the houses, what it does is it kind of collects houses which are very similar to each other, on the graph, and puts them as hexagons. And basically darker colors indicate that a lot of prices, lot of houses in that region, which basically says, for example, in this case you can see this dark, very dark bubble around price 200,000, right? And then you have houses which are dated, the year built is somewhere around 2000-ish, right? So 2000, probably 2-3. So in those kind of cases, you see there's a very dark bubble, which basically means that there are a lot of houses around the price 200,000, which got built around the year 2003-04, right? So that's the intuition that you have from this kind of a plot, right? It's called a joint plot. So it's basically, instead of having bubbles for each of the points as houses, you now have a nice hexagonal distribution, right? So where colors are dense, if colors are darker, if you have a high density of houses in that, area. So if you have a lot of houses with 200,000 price and a lot of houses around the year 2003 or 2004, you would have a lot of you have a darker color there. So that's one kind of a thing. Now John is going to use linear regression for modeling. So it is necessary to remove correlated variables to improve our model. So he must find out the correlations using pandas score function, and can visualization the correlation metrics using C-bound, right? So the understanding is John understands that collinearity is a major assumption in linear regression, and he knows that. So in order to use linear regression, he needs to make sure his features are not related with each other, right? So to do that, he basically can plot a very nice graph which is called a heat map, which basically plots nothing but the correlation of one variable with each other, right? So on this, you have on the y-axis you have all the variables, and on x-axis also you have all the variables, and you can basically plot a very nice correlation heat map, which basically says it's yellow or towards the color yellow if the correlation is high, and it's towards the color purple if its correlation is very nil, right? And in this case you can basically see, and that heat map is also shown on to your right. The purple is correlation is negative, right? So if correlation is extremely negative or correlation is extremely high, it's yellow or purple. If it's somewhere in the middle, it's probably around bluish, right? So you see that a lot of them are actually not correlated with each other. A lot of the actually heat map looks blue, Are there obviously some variables that we can see are sort of yellow, right? For example, we see that garage cars and garage area, right? So those are things which are very highly correlated with each other, right? So we see the yellow kind of, they're almost yellow, which makes sense, right? Garage area and garage cars are probably something which should be related to each other. If there's no area, there's no car. If there's a lot of area, there are more cars. So intuitively, yeah, this makes sense, right? So you get the idea of the heat map, right? So you're basically plotting the correlation values of each feature with every other feature and plotting them as a n cross n grid, right? So you have a grid which has got n variables, split them into n cross n grids, and then each grid is basically the correlation of one feature with the other. So yeah, you can see the inferences from here. So you can see a lot of variables are correlated to sales price, which is good, right? Because you want your features to be correlated with target, not with each other, right? And you can also see that greater living area is something which is highly correlated with total RMS, ABV, GRD, I do not know whatever that variable kind of says. It's probably roof area or something of that sort. Also, the year the garage was built is correlated with the year the building was built, right? So that's obviously something again we would know, right? Obviously, the garage won't be built earlier than the building, or the building won't be built earlier than the garage. So obviously, garage year and the year of the house are something that would again be correlated. So it's a good idea to remove. So now that you know that these variables, these are features which are related with each other, it's probably a good idea to get rid of one of these correlated features, right? So John, what he does is now he basically takes the 10 variables which are highly correlated with sales price, and he's because the idea is that he doesn't want to take all the variables because he sees that a lot of variables are correlated with each other. So he decides on taking the top 10 variables, say, which are very highly correlated with sales price. How does he do that? He takes dataframe.core, and then core is basically correlation, and then he takes n largest, which is basically saying take the largest k for k equals to 10, right? So basically take the 10 largest correlated values, which are top 10 largest correlated columns correlated with sales price, right? So basically checks for all the values which are highly correlated, all the columns which are highly related with sales price, and selects the 10 most correlated columns. And you can plot them again, and you can see the values again. So you are using heat map again, but now instead of plotting all the features n cross n, you just have 10 cross 10, right? So you have got 100 grids, right? 100 cells, and you basically fill them up. And now it looks probably much more better, right? So you basically see that all the variables are very highly related with sales price, and rest of the variable between themselves are probably not as much related. So this is what I was saying, garage cars and garage area were also correlated variables, which makes sense. Again, total basement area and floors for SFR also makes sense. So based on this, after you kind of take the top most correlated features, you can kind of remove the features. After looking at the heat map, you can remove the features which are correlated with each other. So one of the brute force method to also visualize numeric variables is just take pair plots. Pair plots is basically, you basically say here pass some 6-7 columns, and then you plot, take pairs of each of them, right? So you basically take all possible combinations of two from those six lists and then plot them, right? So you basically take sales price cross overall quality, sales price cross greater living area, sales price cross garage area, and all of those sorts, all possible two pair combinations that you can think of from this list, right? You take all of them and plot them, right? So in case it's a plot within itself, it's a histogram. As you can see, sales price with itself is a histogram. Similarly, overall quality with itself is a histogram. For the rest of the cases, when it's plotting two other variables, it's just a scatter plot, right? So pair plot is basically just plotting all possible combinations, and that's it, right? From this, you can kind of infer how the data also looks like. So this is another way to do multivariate numeric analysis. So now the next part is numeric versus categorical, right? So we have talked about numeric versus categorical. So John figured out that if you're plotting numeric versus categorical, one of the easier ways is basically to use box plots. So box plots is basically nothing but we are already familiar with it, right? So what you're going to do is for each of the categories of the categorical variable, you're going to plot a box plot, right? So you have, for example, sales price versus neighborhood. Now for each of the neighborhoods, you're going to plot how the sales price kind of varies, right? And how better to plot that using box plot. So you would have basically different boxes for each of the neighborhoods. And that's awesome. That's easy to understand as well, right? So for each neighborhood, you can see that, hey, I can very well see that probably this area around, Sawyer or something probably has got a lot of outliers, right? So you can kind of see that the IQR is also very high. So probably that has got more expensive houses, right? The maximum value is probably very high. The maximum value is also probably very high for this area around Stonebridge or Gilbert, I don't know. Whichever this is, basically you can see this blue box, right, which has got a very high value. So those kind of says that those places are also probably very expensive places. So that's something that you can kind of infer very easily from a box plot kind of a thing, right? You're plotting your numeric variable, which is sales price, versus categorical variable, which is a neighborhood. So next is something which is very similar to box plot, which is called a SOM plot. But they also show the number of houses, right? So instead of just plotting them as different kind of the box and whisker plot, it's not a box and whisker plot anymore. What you basically see is the number of houses, right? So for example, sales price and overall quality. So sales price is a continuous variable. Overall quality is a discrete variable, which basically can take values from 1, 2, 3, and 10, right? And basically for each overall quality, you basically say that what is the distribution of sales price. So for example, for 10, you basically have the distribution of sales price, right? Each point is basically one particular house, right? So it's sort of a scatter plot, but a scatter plot on a straight line, right? So one axis, you basically, it just the y values are changing, right? And the x values are kind of just fixed at one point. So that's the understanding of what we are kind of trying to do at SOM plots. Obviously, another thing to kind of keep in mind is obviously the denser, if there's a lot of houses in one region, that would probably indicate a lot of density around this, right? So you can see a lot of density around 5, 6, 4. So again, something which is very similar to box plots. So very intuitive ways of kind of going around plotting categorical versus numeric variable, right? So obviously, as you can see that there's a marked increase in sales price as the overall quality increases. So using this variable for a linear regression is actually a good idea, right? So now the final part, which is categorical versus categorical. So this can be done using cross-tab or graphically using a stacked bar plot. So John here considers two variable, neighborhood and overall quality, right? So we have talked about sales price versus neighborhood. We have talked about sales price versus overall quality. Now we are talking about neighborhood versus overall quality. Both of them are categorical variable. How can you kind of plot them? So one way is obviously cross-tab. Cross-tab is basically you kind of see the frequency, right? So this is more like pivot table in Excel of sorts, right? So you basically have overall quality as your columns and neighborhoods as your rows. And this is sort of a data frame, right? So you basically see the number of houses which has got different. In any given location, you can see the number of houses with different overall quality. For example, you can basically see that there's a house with, in this Bloomington, you have got houses with overall quality maximum around 14. You have got three houses with overall quality 8 and of sorts, right? So very easy to interpret. Now the other kind of thing you can do is basically stacked bar plots. So stacked bar plots is nothing but the same thing where you basically for each area, for each neighborhood, neighborhood is on your x-axis. And what you do is you basically plot histograms. You are kind of still trying to plot histograms. So at each locality, you would basically have one bar. And the idea is that bar would basically, the height of that bar is equivalent to the frequency. And you divide that bar proportionally in terms of the number of houses from each quality, overall quality, right? So, for example, you have the different colors for different houses, right, of different overall qualities. And what you do is you basically plot a histogram, height. When you say histogram, I mean the height of the bar is basically equivalent to the frequency of houses in that neighborhood, right? And then based on the proportion of the houses, right? So if In one particular neighborhood, there's 10% of overall quality 1, there's 20% of overall quality 2, then 5% of overall quality 3. So then you basically stack one after the other, right? And you divide the bar into those proportions. So that's all about there is in categorical versus categorical. So you're just taking the bar and splitting them into heights as proportional to the number of houses belonging to the other kind of categorical variable, right? So that's about it. So you can read further about this, and there's a different library called Bokeh, and you can also implement different other design principles in Matplotlib and Python notebook. You can have a look into that. That's your additional resources. Apart from that, nothing else on my side to add. This is the end of the session. So we have talked in this session about how to distinguish between numeric and categorical variables. Then we talked about univariate analysis, where we talked about numerical features, histogram plotting, kernel density estimation, and then box plots. Then we talked about multivariate analysis, where we talked about numeric versus numeric, where we talked about scatter plots, LM plots, all of those things. We talked about numeric versus categorical. We talked about in numeric versus categorical. We talked about box plots, right, for each of the categories. And then categorical versus categorical, we just talked about stacked bar plots, right? So that's about it. That's the entire thing about EDA. Obviously, very short session, very easy to understand. Nothing very high funded. But the only thing to kind of keep in mind while you kind of go ahead is this, that it's something that is absolutely critical and very, very helpful if you have no clue about the data. Obviously, if you are someone who's been working in real estate for 15 years, then you probably know what variables are going to influence sales price. But if you are someone who doesn't have any idea, well, then this kind of things, right, doing EDA can help you a lot in kind of inferring which variable to use versus which variable not to use. So keep that in mind, you know, look out for those correlation metrics, heat maps, do all of that iteratively a lot more number of times till you get an idea of which variables are useful for prediction, which variables are not. So that's about it. That's a wrap from my end. See you on the next lecture.
Log on to GreyAtom's learning platform to unlock more free content. Subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon for regular updates.